Hello, hello everybody, and welcome to Tuscany. Benvenuti in Toscana. We are here to welcome you to the very first episode of Cars in Tuscany, where we try to bring you classic, modern classic, and supercars whenever we can get our hands on them, in the beautiful scenery of Tuscany, which is the land we all grew up in and we all love. We are here at Nello's Villa today in beautiful, beautiful Cortona, coming to you from this brand new renovated property, which sleeps 20 people and has the works. This gorgeous outdoor swimming pool with this lovely fountain, an indoor spa, heated swimming pool, 10 huge, beautiful rooms, and it's a brand new renovation that went on all through COVID. It took almost 3 years to renovate this house. We thank the owners for allowing us to film here for the very first episode of Cars in Tuscany. For information on Nello's, this wonderful property, there will be a link in the description below. Please go check it out for rentals, holidays, weddings, anniversaries, anything you want. It is your getaway place in Tuscany and in Cortona, one of the most beautiful villas we've ever seen. But now on to the main purpose of our visit here today for this very first episode of Cars in Tuscany. And we couldn't not start this series with a Ferrari because we are proud Tuscans, but we are even prouder Italians. You see, I grew up dreaming about this car as a teenager. The car that came before it, the 355, was the last of the old Ferraris. This is the first of the modern Ferraris, and it came into being just as I was getting old enough to learn how to drive. So I lusted after this car, and 22 years after, I finally managed to buy this. The 360 keeps the Dino engine concept that had been with Ferrari since the 1970s. It is the last Ferrari to do so, later being replaced by the 4.3-liter engine that Ferrari developed for the F430. The 3.6-liter V8 produces 400 brake horsepower, and it had the highest horsepower per liter of any aspirated V8 of the time, with an impressive 112 horsepower at an equally impressive 8,750 RPM, which basically means every time you rev this car significantly, a small tree dies somewhere. Oh, I almost forgot. Before we set off, you must know that in Italy, many people keep a little effigy or a picture of their patron saint in the car for protection, good luck, and so on. We've also decided to do that, but just a little differently. And we have here our patron saint, Saint Greta. Let's roll. Ah. Thank you, Greta. Heaven on earth is a manual Ferrari, if you ever had any doubts. Today we are heading towards Val d'Orcia from Cortona, about an hour and a half. It's one of the most beautiful valleys in southern Tuscany. And the first thing that comes to mind while you're driving towards Val d'Orcia is just how supremely comfortable this car is. The director, Federico, is with me today in the car traveling. And we are both 6 foot, and I'm not slim, and we are both very comfortable inside this car. You can really go on driving for another couple of hours, or even on a romantic getaway, if Federico were an attractive woman, which he isn't. Which brings us to another difficult aspect of this car, fuel economy, which is horrendous, as you might expect from a car like this. Now, we've decided to give you those figures anyways, but we're gonna do it our way, because we want to unify the imperial and metric systems so people on both sides of the pond can really understand what's going on in terms of fuel consumption. That's why we're going to give you these figures in dinosaurs, because the crew tells me that's where oil comes from. In any case, the crew have calculated with a certain degree of accuracy that this car burns about 1/8 of a small dinosaur per mile, be that as it may. Another thing that comes to mind when you drive this car is just how easy, how simple and how pleasurable it is to drive it. This manual transmission is a work of art, and the car itself is smooth as butter for a 20-year-old supercar. You can even let your teenager drive this car, provided you love them enough. But beware, driving this car is easy,
But driving this car fast is very, very difficult. These mid-engine Ferraris, especially the older ones, they will hold and hold and hold. But when they let go all of a sudden and you're done. And how could we not mention this magnificent tubi exhaust, made in Maranello, the home of Ferrari as well. It is the stuff of dreams. It's like a Swiss watch that sings. It's like a soprano that keeps on going higher and higher and higher. And another thing we love about this tubi exhaust system, above 6,000 RPM, it gets even louder. So you can't hear the passengers screaming! All in all, this is also a fairly rare car, because while there were 16,200 360s produced, only 7,000 of them were Spiders. And of those, only 1,641 were produced with this gorgeous manual transmission, which makes it a fairly rare car. If you want to examine the actual internal specifications as well, if you look at the grigio alloy, which was the original launch color for this car, with the blue leather interiors and the manual gearbox, you're probably talking about 10 cars worldwide, maybe a few more, but not many. Now, before we get into the technical data itself, it's interesting to note how Ferraris get their name, because many people are confused by this. For instance, the 355, which came before this car did, was a 3.5-liter V8 with 5 valves per cylinder, whereas the 360, slightly larger displacement, 3.6 liters, still 5 valves, 360. The 430, much larger increase in engine size, up to 4.3 liters, therefore, F430. So that's the short version of how Ferraris get their name. Now, needless to say, most modern sports cars will absolutely demolish the 360 in any sort of competition. That just goes without saying. Take, for instance, an Audi RS3 or a BMW M2. They will destroy this car under every single aspect. But who cares? That's not the point of owning a classic Ferrari. It never was. Lots of people tend to be very worried when it comes to these cars because of the maintenance aspect and the cost thereof. I'm here to tell you that's not necessarily true, and it's not necessarily such a disaster. This car, if properly upkept, will cost you about 1,000 euros or $1,000 per year, more or less, give or take. Remember, every 3 years you must do the timing belt service, even if you haven't put any miles on the car, because if the timing belt breaks on a car like this, you are in very serious trouble. Now, on the old 355, doing the timing belt was a major ordeal because the whole engine block had to come out of the car, and that cost a lot of money to do. Thankfully, they fixed this issue in the 360. Behind the seats, there is a hatch conveniently located, and when removed, you can change the timing belt in almost no time. And that costs about $3,000 or 3,000 euros to do every 3 years. You must absolutely remember to do that service. Otherwise, if the timing belt breaks, you might as well throw away the car. Oh, and one more thing for our German and Porsche-loving friends who always tell me, ah, Ferrari, Ferrari is great, but you cannot go to the supermarket with a Ferrari, you can't use a Ferrari every day. Yes, you can use this car every day, and yes, you can go to the supermarket with it. As a matter of fact, I have more boot space in this car than in a 911, and I'll show you. There. I am 6 foot and 180 pounds.
Anche meno.
E che cavolo, allora 190. Sì, va bene, 204, va bene. As you can see, I fit fairly comfortably inside the boot of this car. Maybe for short trips, though. If you remove me, you can actually fit 2 full-size cabin bags inside this boot, which makes this an ideal car for a weekend out. One of the questions I get asked fairly often with this car, which always makes me laugh a little bit, is, do Ferraris catch on fire? I've heard they catch on fire. The answer is no. Sports cars, in general, will have a tendency to be more at risk for that, which is why they usually have fire extinguishers, but they are high-performance machines. The AMG Mercedes station wagon has a fire extinguisher under the front seat, and that's a family car with a large engine. But I will tell you what does catch on fire. Ferraris with poor maintenance. That is what will make them catch on fire really quickly. And in any case, If this car actually should catch on fire, I want you all to know I want it to be cremated anyways, and I like my steak medium rare. Now, since perfection doesn't really exist anywhere in the world, even this car has to have at least one fault. Now, it has probably more than one, but mainly it has one which I find difficult to tolerate. It's this clock. Who in their right mind thought that it would be a good idea to put this piece of crap here? A clock like this is one of the reasons birth control was invented. And therefore, today, I have taken a radical decision. And I do mean radical. Thankfully, in the end, thanks to the crew who had a brilliant intuition, cooler heads prevailed, and we decided to do that. There. Much better. Cars can have souls. That is what you take away from this car. Cars can have souls. At least they could when I was growing up. You could even feel it when they screamed past you and you were not even in them. It was a dream, and I've always believed that if you really, really want something in life, truly want it, chances are you can achieve that thing. It took me 22 years to live the dream I had at 18 of owning this car. I could have bought something modern, more powerful, more technological. But this was a choice that came from the heart, and the heart should always win. You feel so connected to this car, to the ground beneath it, to the wind all around it. You could drive for hours and still dream about driving it when you return home to rest. What an astonishing car this is. It was handmade by people with a mind and people with a heart, not by a robotic arm on an assembly line. The soul of this car is the soul behind the hands that built it and the passion in the fingers that drew its lines and curves. And this is when we head home. At the end of a long day, on windy roads where the smell of cypresses fills the air and the hills of the Val d'Orcia roll on by. As summer turns to autumn, and the air is so crisp, and the sun is low in the sky, and then, just before dusk, it overflows over the horizon with the warmest golden orange light. It transfixes you for just a few seconds, and then gives way to the bluest dark sky of night.
Sì, sì, giriamo oggi, sì che giriamo. We're filming today. Yes, we're filming today. Good camera, good camera, yes.